What's the most important thing in the world? Love? Money? What about food? Food makes our bodies move, our hearts beat, and our cells function. We don't exist without it. Every day in the hunt for food, 32 million of us go to the grocery store and pick it, wrapped in glossy plastic and printed boxes, right off the shelves, which are never empty. Those boxes arrive day and night on trucks. Trucks are very important. They carry our food to grocery stores from factories and fields far away. Fields are farmed by enormous tractors and harvesters, which all run on fuel. And fuel comes from oil. Oil makes everything in this chain work, so oil must be the most important thing in the world. Oil makes the world move. We use 19 million barrels per day in the U.S., 90 million worldwide. About half of that becomes gasoline for our cars, a quarter diesel fuel for trucks, boats, and heating, 10% jet fuel. The rest becomes propane, asphalt, industrial fuels, chemicals, plastics, and electricity. Oil is worth a lot of energy. It gives more heat per pound than coal or wood. It's relatively easy to refine, can be shipped in any sized container, and made into thousands of objects and materials. A single barrel of oil is worth 10 to 15,000 hours of human labor, over a year and a half of steady, round-the-clock work. We pour that into our gas tanks by the gallon. Trucks burn that fuel, hauling almost all farm products from fields to factories to grocery stores. They also bring gasoline for purchase to service stations and truck stops. There are 26 million commercial trucks in the U.S., including 2.5 million tractor trailers. Imagine a day without trucks. We would have no Amazon.com, UPS, Post Office, FedEx, Walmart, Whole Foods, Best Buy, fast food, grocery stores, garbage collection, street cleaning, recycling, or gas stations. We'd have no airlines. Trucks bring their fuel and supplies. No banks. Trucks replenish coins and cash and deliver signed documents. And no water supply. Trucks bring the chemicals used to process and sanitize water. Without trucks, hospitals would quickly run out of pharmaceuticals and surgical supplies, and electrical repair, road maintenance, and all construction would cease. We are not equipped on a local level to supply most, if any, of what we need to survive. This is a precarious and fragile system, depending entirely on cheap fuel. Why did we build something so important on one finite commodity? Once upon a time, we could afford to. In the late 1800s, America discovered oil. In Pennsylvania, Ohio, and Indiana, a string of boom towns exploded onto the landscape, and a new industry was born. As oil fields were drained, new fields were discovered, and the boom moved west. In the early 1900s, giant fields in Texas and California dwarfed all previous discoveries, producing millions of barrels per week, and soon per day. At times, there was so much oil that you could buy a barrel, that's 42 gallons, for 3 cents, less than the cost of a single glass of water. This overabundance caused a panic among oil producers. There was simply too much of it, and it was too cheap to produce. The sheer volume of oil threatened to bankrupt the industry. Then, in 1908, Henry Ford began manufacturing the machine that would help us burn our oil. We think of the car as an efficient and practical device. Nothing could be further from the truth. The automobile wastes about 80% of the gasoline it burns. The energy is lost to heat and friction and never makes it to the wheels. Your car is essentially an expensive, mobile, heating device. The car was the perfect machine to spend our glut and keep us coming back for more. In 1927, Ford produced its 15 millionth Model T. By 1965, there were 90 million cars and trucks on the road. Today, there are 250 million in the U.S. and over a billion in the world. In the 1940s, powered by oil, we transformed our military, building the world's largest army of trucks, tanks, battleships, and jet planes. In World War II, the U.S. supplied 6 of the 7 billion barrels used by the Allies to win the war. In the 1950s, we shook off the gas and food rationing of wartime and celebrated by giving ourselves two gifts, big cars and a national highway system, a playground for our automobiles. Under the influence of cheap oil, our towns and fields, which used to live together, move further and further and further apart. Now we put millions of trucks on the road to bring food from distant fields to our quiet, bug-free, chemically treated suburban palaces. Trucks are the least fuel-efficient of vehicles, getting about 6 miles per gallon, but we use them as our food and water lifeline. Trains get much better mileage, but in the glut of oil, we let our urban tracks wither and die, and made our world into an endless knot of tar and concrete. In 1790, with a population of 4 million people, 90% of Americans worked on farms. By 1900, it was 38%. Today, less than 2% of the U.S. population farms in a nation of 320 million people. In the oil age, we altered the way we grow food. Instead of using ancient methods, natural fertilizers, crop rotation, and growing a variety of local foods, we use oil to power giant machines to farm single crops on hundreds of millions of acres. To protect these unnatural monocrops from insects and disease, we soak them with pesticides made from oil. We use oil to mine for minerals to feed our fields, leaving behind toxic byproducts and rapidly draining our large but limited supply. We even use a petroleum byproduct to fertilize our fields. Natural gas is converted, under great heat and pressure, into ammonia, which we spray on the depleted soil to feed it nitrogen. When we didn't have enough water for our new fields and cities, we used oil to power the machinery, to dam rivers, build pipelines from distant valleys, and pump water from ancient underground aquifers. We used this stolen water to grow the thirstiest of crops and animals in dry grasslands and near deserts. We're now pumping these aquifers into steep decline. Our industrial farms, powered by oil, are headed for a collision with real-world limits. For 200,000 years, human beings were foragers. We spent a calorie of our own energy to bring back 10 calories of food. 10 for one. That was a good return on investment. Now we do the opposite. We spend 10 calories of oil and gas to produce 1 calorie of food. Tomatoes, grown in Italy, are processed, put into bags from the Netherlands, shipped to Sweden, made into ketchup, and poured into bottles made of plastics from 5 countries. Fish caught in Scotland are frozen, shipped to China, thawed, deboned, refrozen, and shipped back. Sugarcane picked in Hawaii is refined, shipped to San Francisco, refined again, then shipped to New York, where it's packaged before being shipped back to Hawaii and the rest of the world. California, a desert state in a severe drought, is responsible for growing most of the fresh fruit and vegetables consumed in the United States, which are flown and driven cross-country, night and day. Companies like Monsanto are now in charge of our worldwide food supply. They're altering seeds, soaking them in pesticides, and changing their genetic structure. Monsanto says they need to do this to feed us all. Activists point out that the pesticides are toxic and the altered food has little nutritional value. Monsanto may be in the wrong, but there's an irony we're not facing. Why are we protesting them for growing food when we won't do it for ourselves? In the early 1900s, the oil fields of California and Texas had a better energy return than our food crops. For every barrel of oil we sunk into drilling, we'd get hundreds and even thousands out of the ground. Oil is old plant material, algae, compressed inside of porous rock under extreme pressure. When a hole is drilled, that pressure forces the oil up, through the well, to the surface. After years of pumping, the pressure in the reservoir declines, and the remaining oil becomes harder to pull out. In oil drilling, what goes up always comes down. Engineers have developed ways to get more oil out of declining fields by pumping in steam, seawater, and natural gas to increase pressure. This requires large volumes of energy. We're burning oil to get oil. The world's great oil fields, from the U.S., South America, and Mexico, to Russia, the North Sea, and Saudi Arabia, are all in decline, some slowly, some swiftly, but all irreversibly, inexorably. The days of 100-to-1 oil are long gone. The remaining untapped oil fields are not on land, but in the deep ocean. Some are many miles under the sea floor. An oil well on land costs between $1 million and $15 million, depending on its depth and complexity. But a deep-sea drilling platform can cost over $600 million. Deep-water fields decline much faster than those on land and have shorter lifespans. They're harder, more dangerous, and more expensive to produce, and the spills can be cataclysmic. Fracking and tar sands are two newer ways to get oil. Fracked oil lives in tight, non-porous shale. It doesn't flow and needs to be fractured out of long, horizontally drilled holes by millions of gallons of chemically infused water under great pressure. This has a tendency to pollute water tables. Old oil fields decline slowly, at 4 or 5% per year after reaching their peak. Fracked wells decline immediately, at 40 to 70% per year. The energy return on fracking is about 10 to 1. Tar sands are oil deposits that escape their reservoirs and float upward into surface sand, dirt, and stone. This oil can't be pumped and doesn't flow. It has to be mined, heated in vast quantities of water, and processed using even more oil and gas. It's a slow, difficult process that destroys the local environment. Its energy return is, at best, 3 to 1. As oil becomes harder to mine and produce, the cost of oil and gas, and everything that relies on it, can do nothing but increase. From 1900 to 1940, oil hit lows of pennies per barrel, with an average national cost of a dollar, slowly rising to two, where it stayed through the 1940s, 50s, and 60s. At the same time, gasoline cost between 20 and 35 cents per gallon. In 1971, the U.S. oil fields peaked and began to decline. In 1974, oil approached $12 per barrel, causing a national panic, but the price kept climbing. In 2006, a barrel of oil cost $65, and the U.S. was importing over half of the oil we used. In mid-2008, oil reached $140 per barrel, and trucking fuel approached $5 per gallon, causing a slowdown in travel and industry. Fracking, now cost competitive, was brought in to boost our supply. Since then, fracked oil has flooded the market, driving the price back down into the $60 range. But these wells are now in steep decline. Analysts are expecting the price of oil to rise and remain extremely volatile. This is the alarm. What will we do when oil is too hard to get or too costly to fuel our vast trucking fleet, to power our jet planes, to run the giant diesel machines that pump our aquifers onto chemically treated fields, to keep our store shelves from going empty? The world that we've built on the power of cheap oil is not sustainable when oil is expensive, limited, and increasingly toxic. But governments will not admit this for fear of causing mass panic. Instead, we're fracking, mining, and going to war to hold on to what remains. But war burns oil and won't increase world supplies. And fracking, mining, and deep-sea drilling won't give us the volume we require. The hundreds of billions of barrels we waste on inefficient machines, burning gas along 1,000-mile trucking routes, just to maintain our coast-to-coast, worldwide supply chain. The world that we've built on cheap, abundant oil is in real danger of catastrophic collapse, and neither government, protests, or buying our way out of it is going to fix this for us. What we need is a plan. What if we could shorten the road between the field and the town? What if our food was a walk or bike ride away? What if trucks only had to travel a mile or two to bring us what we need to stay healthy and alive? Our fields, stuffed into the Midwest and California, need to find their way back to the rest of the country. It's time to grow food again, like we used to, in back and front yards, in neighborhoods, school grounds, in communities, at colleges, hospitals, and around city halls, in the green spaces around highways and superstores that are growing nothing but grass and weeds. We have to rethink the way we view our neighborhoods, public land, roadsides, and open spaces. Where there are now empty lots, we can plant food forests and community gardens. Where we're used to homeowners associations telling us how green our lawns must be, we now must make our lawns fertile places for food to grow. Most of us have forgotten how to grow food. The good news is, it's easier than you think, and easier still in groups. Digging a plot in a yard requires a shovel and a few hours of work. You'll need some mulch and weed cloth to line the bed and keep the grass from growing in, and of course, good seeds and water. If you have good soil in your yard, use it. Raised beds, or square foot gardening, works in most environments, even those with bad soil. You need 4 pieces of wood, a weed mat, mulch, good soil, water, and seeds. Hydroponics is a soilless indoor-outdoor method which produces high yields of leafy vegetables, but requires electricity, a small pump to circulate water, and a growing medium, clay pellets, vermiculite, or even coconut husk. Aquaponics introduces fish into the system, which provide plant nutrients, as well as a food for you, or your cat. A compost pile is essential for a garden. It's a box or pile of degrading food scraps, leaves, and plant material that is converted into nutrient-rich soil by heat and bacteria. Biodynamic farming and integrated pest management are organic systems that can be used to grow food in larger areas. Permaculture is the most sustainable method of growing food. It works in layers, from fruit and nut trees, to fruiting shrubs, to perennial food crops and waterways, in a self-sustaining system. You can learn about all of these by doing a web search, visiting your local library, or going to meetup.com and searching for groups in your area. Growing food is a growing movement, and it's not hard to find. Our country, and your city and town, needs farmers, food growers, textile makers, and artisans. In order to free ourselves from the web of oil, war, and pollution, we need to be busy every day building local economies, using local produce and products that feed and nurture us right where we live, in our towns, neighborhoods, and homes. If the 20th century was about distancing ourselves from our rural roots, from fields and farming, then the 21st is about coming back to it, with lessons learned and technologies gained from our grand experiment with oil, but with a new respect for the most important thing in the world, the earth beneath our feet that gives us what we require to live.